الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سورة البقرة سورة نمبر 2 آية نمبر 75 أفتطمعون أن يؤمنوا لكم وقد كان فريق منهم يسمعون كلام الله ثم يحرفونه من بعد ما عقلوه وهم يعلمون وإذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا وإذا خلا بعضهم إلى بعض قالوا أتحدثونهم بما فتح الله عليكم ليحاجوكم به عند ربكم أفلا تعقلون أولا يعلمون أن الله يعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون ومنهم أميون لا يعلمون الكتاب إلا أماني وإنهم إلا يظنون فويل للذين يكتبون الكتاب بأيديهم ثم يقولون هذا من عند الله ليشتروا به ثمنا قليلا فويل لهم مما كتبت أيديهم وويل لهم مما يكسبون وقالوا لن تمسنا النار إلا أياما معدودة قل أتخذتم عند الله عهدا فلن يخلف الله عهده أم تقولون على الله ما لا تعلمون بلى من كسب سيئة وأحاطت به خطيئته فأولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون والذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أولئك أصحاب الجنة هم فيها خالدون صدق الله العظيم سورة البقرة سورة نمبر 2 آية نمبر 75 الله سبحانه وتعالى in these ayahs of Surah Al-Baqarah is mentioning the mischief and the disobedience of Bani Israel. Before their mischief, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the favors and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He has provided them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the previous ayat about a dozen immense and enormous blessings and the favors Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon the Bani Israel. So let me briefly count all the blessings and the favors Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them. The first favor was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preferred them over other people, as for example, Qibtis, the Qom of Fir'aun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in ayah number 47 of Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَتِيَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَإِنِّي فَضَّلْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ O children of Israel, remember my favor that I have bestowed upon you and that I preferred you over the worlds. In the next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the second favor Allah He has bestowed upon them. That he saved them from Fir'aun and his torment when they were in great trouble. The third favor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala parted the sea for them and saved them from Fir'aun and his torment. This favor is mentioned in ayah number 50. The fourth favor is mentioned in ayah 51 when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with 70 people of Bani Israel for 40 nights on Tur mountain. The fifth favor is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them after the worship of the calf and did not punish them. The sixth favor is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Musa alayhi salatu wasalam Torah for the guidance of his people, for the guidance of Bani Israel. The seventh favor was when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam asked them to ask the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the worship of the calf in his absence when he went to Tur mountain to take Torah with the 70 people of Bani Israel. They asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for repentance and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them. The eighth favor was when they asked Musa alayhi salatu wasalam that they would not believe until they see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outright with their own eyes. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this brought the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to them, and the thunderbolt seized them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revived them after their extinction. The ninth favor was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the white cloud to overshadow them and sent down on them manna salwa in the valley of Ti when they were wandering therein and they had nothing to eat. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam asked for them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them something to eat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them manna salwa. This is also one of the blessings, one of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the tenth favor was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, go to this town. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means here Baytul Maqdis, as commentators have said, and eat freely of that which is therein. And the 11th favor was when they needed water after food. They had already eaten manna salwa bestowed upon them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now they were thirsty. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for water, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them 12 springs. They were gushed out of the rock when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam touched the rock, and the 12 springs were gushed out of the rock, one for their each clan, because they were all of them were 12 clans, 12 tribes of Bani Israel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned these favors and blessings in the glorious Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah from ayah 47 to ayah 60. Now from ayah 61 to ayah 83, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning their mischief and disobedience. After these, all the blessings and all the favors Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them, they were that much mischievous, that much obedient, that after these all the blessings, still they did not change. They did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his prophet, and they did not change their habit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided them with these all the blessings and all the favors, but they were so much mischievous and disobedient towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his prophets that they did not care about these all the favors. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are on the sixth mischief today. Let me briefly count all the five mischiefs, five disobedience which they have done again to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first disobedience was when they called Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with his name instead of saying Ya Rasulullah or Ya Nabi Allah. When they said Wa idh qultum ya Musa lan nasbir ala ta'amin wahid. They were supposed to say Wa idh qultum ya Rasulullah or Ya Nabi Allah, but they named Musa alayhi salatu wasalam with his name, and this was the disrespect of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning their disobedience. The second disobedience was when they denied to accept and follow some of the commandments of Torah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala held a mount over them and asked them to hold fast when what was given to them. Then again, they turned away from the teachings, from the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Torah and Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. The third disobedience was when they transgressed concerning the Yawm al-Sabt, as you have learned it already, the day of Saturday. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them apes and monkeys, which were despised and rejected. The fourth disobedience was when they asked Musa alayhi salatu wasalam unnecessary questions about the cow. The fifth disobedience was when one of them killed a man from amongst them, and they blamed each other for it. We have learned it already, it passed. Today, we will start from ayah number 75. And in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the sixth disobedience of mischief of Bani Israel. In the previous ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned many mischiefs and misbehaviors, misconducts of Bani Israel they have seen so many signs, so many things from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Despite of that, they have seen these signs. They did not accept the truth. They did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messengers and prophets. Their hearts became hardened like stones, or even more harder. The believers and the mu'mineen, the Muslims, the followers of Islam, followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to take great pains. They used to try hard to make them accept Islam. They used to go to them and to ask them to accept Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing in this ayah the believers, the mu'mineen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ, do you covet, O believers? وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ, that they would believe for you while a party of them used to hear the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ and وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ, and then distort it knowingly after they had understood it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to mu'mineen, to the believers, O believers, do not expect from them that they will accept your deen, they will accept your religion, and they will accept and follow your prophet. So do not be worried much about them. They are not going to accept Islam. They will not accept Islam. How can you expect from them that they can accept Islam, while their forefathers were the people that they used to change the Kalamullah, they used to distort the Kalamullah and made the changes in that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another ayah about the distortion of Torah and other suhuf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in another ayah about this mischief, that فَبِمَا نَقُضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ لَعَنَّاهُمْ وَجَعَلْنَا قُلُوبَهُمْ قَاسِيَةً يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمَّ مَوَاضِعِهِ وَنَسُوا حَظًّا مِمَّا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ. So for their breaking of the covenant, we cursed them and made their hearts hard. They distort words from their proper usages and have forgotten a portion of that of which they were reminded. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the same mischief, about the same disobedience of them, is mentioning in another ayah in the glorious Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مِنَ الَّذِينَ هَادُوا يُحَرِّفُونَ الْكَلِمَ عَمَّ مَوَاضِعِهِ وَيَقُولُونَ سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. That among the Jews are those who distort words from their proper usages, and they clearly say, we hear and disobey. وَيَقُولُونَ سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا, we hear the Kalamullah, we hear the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then we disobey. And they don't have any kind of shame of by saying this thing, that we hear the Kalamullah and we disobey. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns the believers in this ayah, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ, to realize that the people who are so enslaved to their desires, and they are so shameless in their pursuits of evil, you cannot expect from them to listen to you. They themselves say that وَيَقُولُونَ سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا, we hear and disobey. When they themselves are saying that we listen to the words of Allah and disobey, so how can you expect from these kinds of mischievous and disobedient people from them to accept Islam, to accept your religion? Ibn Kathir rahimahullah ta'ala says that Ibn Ziyad rahimahullah ta'ala commented the word Kalamullah. The word Kalamullah in this ayah, أَفَتَطْمَعُونَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا لَكُمْ وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ. So commentators have commented on this word, that the Yahud, the Jews, Bani Israel, they have made changes in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Kalamullah, and they changed its meanings, and they changed the words themselves. Qatada rahimahullah ta'ala says that those were their scholars, and they used to change the words and the meanings of the book of Torah, of the book of Allah, Torah, which was revealed to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Ibn Ziyad, rahimahullahu ta'ala, says about it, they altered the Torah and its meanings. They changed lawful into unlawful and unlawful into lawful. So when a person seeking the truth used to come to them with a bribe, they used to judge in his case from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when a person used to come to them seeking to do evil with a bribe, they used to take out the book of their which was written from their own hands, and they used to judge his case accordingly, according to their own handwritten book. When a person used to come to them for an evil without any bribe, somebody used to come to them for a bad thing, for a wrong thing, but he used not to bring any kind of bribe, any kind of money, any kind of asset, so they used to tell them the righteous things, they used to enjoin righteous on him, because this time they were not expecting anything, any kind of asset, any kind of bribe in return from him. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them in another ayah in the glorious Quran, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you enjoin piety and righteousness on the people and you forget to practice it yourselves while you recite the book? Will you not understand? Don't you have this much understanding? Some of the scholars said other things about the word Kalamullah. Some of them say that the Kalamullah refers to that when 70 people of Bani Israel went with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam on the mountain Tur to hear Torah directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the distortion, tahrif, refers to that when they came back, they told their people, Bani Israel, who were left behind with Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, they said to them, when after coming back from there, from mountain Tur, that we heard from Allah directly, but at the end, Allah subhanahu, Allah promised us to forgive us if we leave some commandments, if we leave some of the teachings of Torah that we cannot act upon. This was the distortion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them to practice and to follow the commandments and the teachings of Torah. But after coming back to their own people, they said that at the end Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had promised us that if you cannot do something, if you cannot follow some of the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so do not worry about it, you can leave them, you don't need to act upon those commandments which you don't want to act upon. This is very important to know here, that the Jews of the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam may not have themselves been involved in these transgressions, in these mischiefs, but since they did not abhor the acts of their forefathers, so they will be considered the followers of them, they will be considered the followers of their forefathers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning here about them. Here, on a personal note, the book Ijaz-e-Isvi, if you want to know more about the tahrif, about the distortion in the meaning and the words of Torah, of Injil, and we want to know more about it, so the book Ijaz-e-Isvi, this is originally written in Urdu language by Sheikh Rahmatullah Al-Kairanwi Al-Makki Rahimahullah Ta'ala, is a masterpiece when we talk about the distortion of Torah and Injil.
English available?
It's, I don't know about English, but in Urdu it is available. But he has his another book, Izharul Haq, the Izharul Haq, the revealed truth, yeah. So this Izharul Haq book was written in Arabic language by Rahmatullah Kairanwi Al-Makki. So he has written one chapter in this book also about the distortion of Torah and Injil. This book, the second book, Izharul Haq, is internationally recognized as one of the most authoritative for the objective studies of Bible. So if anybody wants to know more about the distortion in the in Injil and in Torah, in Bible, so he can refer to that book, to both of these books, Ijaz al-Iswi and Izhar al-Haq, written by Sheikh Rahmatullah al-Kairanwi al-Makki, Rahimahullah ta'ala, who moved later on to Makkatul Mukarramah, and he founded their Adar al-Ulum called Madrasa Sawlatiyya. Ayah 76 and 77, وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا وَإِذَا خَلَى بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ قَالُوا أَتُحَدِّثُونَهُمْ بِمَا فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ لِيُحَاجُّوكُمْ بِهِ عِنْدَ رَبِّكُمْ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ أَوَلَا يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا And when they meet those who believe, قَالُوا آمَنَّا They say, we have believed. وَإِذَا خَلَى بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ But when they are alone with one another, قَالُوا أَتُحَدِّثُونَهُمْ They say, do you talk? They say, بِمَا قَالُوا أَتُحَدِّثُونَهُمْ بِمَا فَتَحَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ Do you talk to them about what Allah has revealed to you? لِيُحَاجُّوكُمْ بِهِ عِنْدَ رَبِّكُمْ So they can argue with you about it before your Lord. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ Have you then no understanding? أَوَلَا يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ Do they not know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they conceal and what they reveal? This is the seventh mischief, seventh disobedience and falsehood of Bani Israel mentioned in these two ayahs. Some of the Jews, when they saw the growing power of the Muslims in Medina al-Munawwara and around it, so they pretended to have accepted Islam. They used to come to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions of him, and they used to say that we have believed in your religion, we have believed in Allah, we have believed in your Prophet. So they would sometimes meet the believers and disclose some truth to hide their hypocrisy from them. That the good tidings, they used to say sometimes so that they can hide their hypocrisy, that the good tidings of coming of your Prophet is written in Torah, in the book of Allah itself. But when they met each other, when they went back to their own leaders and scholars, so when they met them in private, they used to say that we have only accepted Islam just by our tongue. We are very much loyal to our own faith, and that is Judaism. They used to say to them, the scholars of them, the leaders of them, they used to say to them when you used to go back and meet them, that you people do not have even this much understanding, that if you tell the companions of Muhammad what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has foretold you in your book, in Torah, that Muhammad is the final messenger and other signs of his prophecy. It will become a proof against you with your Lord from those sides. Then they will win the dispute in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in front of your Lord, and you will lose. In ayah 77, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is replying himself on behalf of mu'mineen, on behalf of the companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on behalf of the believers and the followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. أَوَلَا يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, what they hide and what they disclose. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the hypocrisy of their iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they talk to one another, and when they are alone, their secret denial and rejection of Prophet Muhammad and his prophecy, and what is recorded in their book about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ayah number 78, وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِي وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَظُنُّونَ وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ And there are among them unlettered ones. لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ Who do not know the book. إِلَّا أَمَانِيَّ Except the desires. وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَظُنُّونَ And they but guess. The previous ayah was talking about the common Jews. أَوَلَا يَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا يُسِرُّونَ وَمَا يُعْلِنُونَ. That ayah was talking about the common Jews who were little bit educated, who were somehow educated, and they had some knowledge of their religion, of their book. In this ayah, وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِيَّ وَإِنْهُمْ إِلَّا يَظُنُّونَ. It is mentioned that there are among them some other people also who did not know anything from the book, who do not know even a single word from the book. They were completely illiterate. They don't know anything from the book Torah. They did not know anything about their religion except what their selfish scholars told them. They had some false desires and wishes. Their minds were stuffed only with baseless superstitions, which they found very pleasant and flattering. They did not know anything from the book, just they had some kind of false desires. The word Ummiyun in the ayah is the plural of Ummi. Ummi is the singular of the word Ummiyun, and it means a person who does not know how to write and read. As the Ummi was one of the descriptions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was also unlettered. He did not know how to read and how to write. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about him in the glorious Quran, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. Neither did you, O Muhammad, read any book before this Quran, nor did you write any book whatsoever with your right hand. In this case, that if you knew how to write and read, the followers of falsehood, these Jews and Christians, might have doubted that you have written this book with your own hand. That's why this was the secret, this was the hikmah and wisdom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not know anything. He did not know how to write and how to read. That's why he is called Ummi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about this description of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said in another ayah, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. That the word Amani in the ayah means that he it is who sent among the Ummiyin, or messenger, Muhammad from among themselves. The word Amani in the ayah, لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِيَّ, is the plural of Amniyyah, and it means the wish and the hope, or false statement, or as they used to say, that fire will not touch them but only for a few days, or there this statement that no one will enter Jannah except Jews. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions their statement in the glorious Quran in another place, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالُوا لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. That these Jews and the Christians, they say that no one enter Jannatul Firdaus, in Jannah, except Yahud, except Jews and Christians. تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ. These are their desires, these are their hopes and wishes, and their false statement. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ. O Muhammad, say to them, produce your proof if you are truthful in your statement. قُلْ هَاتُوا بُرْهَانَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. So Amani is the word of Amniya, and it means here wishes and hopes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they have no base for it except their guess and false desires. This kind of desires and superstitions will not work at all on the day of resurrection in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there this desire, there this wish, or there this hope that there no one will enter Jannah except Jews, this is totally wrong and falsehood from themselves. Ayah 79, فَوَيْلُ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Then woe to those who write the book with their own hands, then say, this is from Allah in order to purchase with it a little price. Woe to them for what their hands have written, and woe to them for what they earned thereby. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah is mentioning their eighth disobedience, falsehood and mischief. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that there is another category of people among these Jews who are their scholars, and they write the book, Torah, with their own hands, and then they tell their own people that this is from Allah. They lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his prophets, and misguide their own people so that they can earn a little amount of money from them in return. This ayah announces a grievous punishment for them for distorting the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and earning money by doing so. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, woe to them because of what they have written with their own hands, the lies, the falsehood and alterations. Woe to them because of the property or assets they have unjustly acquired. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them in another ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِّنَ الْأَحْبَارِ وَالرُّهْبَانِ لَيَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ النَّاسِ بِالْبَاطِلِ. O you who believe, O mu'minin, O believers, indeed, many of the priests and monks from Jews consume the wealth of people unjustly. They tell them false things, wrong things, and then they ask from them some of the assets. The Mufassirin have written several meanings of the word Wailun. The word Wailun, Fawailun lilladina, Fawailun lilladina yaktubun al-kitab. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala said that the Wailun means a severe punishment and a massive destruction. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib rahimahullahu ta'ala said that Wail is a valley in Jahannam. If the mountains of hell are, what is the description? What is the attribute of that valley? That if the mountains of hell are put in that valley and burnt, they will become sand or dust, or like they will start flowing like water out of the heat of that valley. Imam Baghawi rahimahullah ta'ala said, recorded a hadith from Abu Sa'id Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala an, that Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said about this word, about the veil, that veil is a valley in Jahannam. The disbeliever will keep on walking into that valley for 40 years. Even then, he will not reach the bottom. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam told the distance of that valley, that how far it is that valley. The word samanan qalila. In the ayah, there is a word samanan qalila. Samanan qalila means, samanan qalila means, according to the dictionary, it means the little price. But here is not, the meaning is not that little price, rather it means a big amount. But why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about it samanan qalila? The secret behind it, behind saying samanan qalila, is that whatever they earn in this world by saying false things to their followers is very small comparing to their punishment in the hereafter, whatever distortion they have made in Torah, in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So their punishment will be very much bigger. So that punishment, comparing to that punishment, whatever they are earning in this world, that is very, very small. Ayah number 80, وَقَالُوا لَن تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً قُلْ أَتَّخَذْتُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهْدًا فَلَنْ يُخْلِفَ اللَّهُ عَهْدَهُ أَمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. وَقَالُوا, and they say, لَنْ تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَةً, that the fire shall not touch us but for a few number days. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ أَتَّخَذْتُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهْدًا فَلَنْ يُخْلِفَ اللَّهُ عَهْدَهُ أَمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Say, O Muhammad, to them, have you taken a covenant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that Allah will not break his covenant? Or is it that you say of Allah what you do not know? Am taquloon ala Allahi ma la ta'alamoon. Or is it that you say of Allah what you do not know? Here in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about their ninth falsehood, ninth disobedience and false statement. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned their claim as they say that the fire will only touch them for a few days, for a number of days, and then they will be saved from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disproved their claim as he said that, O Muhammad, say to them, have you taken a covenant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If you had a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who does not break his promise. He will keep his promise, but such promise was never made. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make this promise. You are uttering a lie about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have no knowledge of what you are saying. أَمْ تَقُولُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Therefore, your final abode is Jahannam, and you people will stay there in forever. You will stay in Jahannam, in hell, for forever. The commentators have different opinions about Ayyam al-Ma'duda. The word Ayyam al-Ma'duda mentioned in the ayah, the commentators have different opinions. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala said, Jews used to say that the duration of this world is 7,000 years, and they will stay in Jahannam for only 7 days, a day for each 1,000. Some ulama said that those Jews, they used to believe that they will stay in Jahannam for 40 days because the duration of their worshipping the calf when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam left them behind and he went to Mount Tur. So they worship the calf for 40 days, so just they will be punished. They used to believe that. They will be punished for 40 days only. One opinion is that, and this is from the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him that we will stay. They used to come to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they used to say that we will stay in Jahannam for 40 days, then you people will replace us. They said this thing to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a fun. Then we will go to Jahannam, we will go to hell, but then after that you will replace us because you came after us. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his hand on their heads, and Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, no, don't worry about it, but you will remain in Jahannam forever. We will not go to Jahannam. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about it. There is a very interesting hadith, very useful hadith here, and we will inshallah stop after this hadith today. Al-Hafiz Abu Bakr rahimahullahu ta'ala recorded this hadith that Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala narrated that when Khaybar was conquered, a roasted poisoned sheep was presented to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a gift. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to know through the wahi, through the from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this sheep is poisoned. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told that, assemble before me all the Jews who were here. The Jews were summoned. They were called. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I ask you one thing, will you people tell me the truth? They said, O Abu Qasim, yes, we will speak the truth. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them, who is your father? They replied, so and so. He said, you lied. You have told a lie. Your father is so and so. They said, you are right. You have said the correct, and we were liars. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if I ask you about something, will you people tell the truth? Then they replied, yes, O Abu Qasim, and if we tell a lie, you will know our lies as you did about our fathers. We told our fathers so and so, and you told a lie because you came to know about it through the wahi. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, who are the people of the fire? They said, we will stay there for a while, and then you will replace us in it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, may you be cursed and humiliated in it by Allah. We shall never replace you in it. It means you will stay there in Jahannam forever. Then he asked, will you tell me the truth if I ask you a question? They said, yes, O Abu Qasim. He asked, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, have you poisoned this sheep? They said, yes. He asked, "What made you do so? Why did you poison this sheep?" They said, "We wanted to know if you were a liar, we would get rid of you, and if you were a prophet, then the poison will not harm you." This was the hadith narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an, and these were the mischiefs and the misbehaviors and the disobedience of Bani Israel mentioned in the glorious Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah. Inshallah, we will stop here today, and the next Sunday, inshallah, we'll start from ayah number 80 and 82. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.